Brothers killing brothers, sisters dissing each other. Children they had split siblings, now missing each other. From secret societies, you removed all the covers. Abused, cause some choose to be ID'd by color. Negro and black, or claim a fiction on the map. Thought power is wasted on the idol god crap. Nuisance solutions, following illusions. We are old world orders, but we scared of new ones. Some stuck on stupid and being humans. Some hoping Cupid would find her a new man. Sis, it will never be him, only you can. Find the one's nose that won't go like Pinocchio or Toucan. Once you think you can't, you probably won't. Might as well be hanging on a Klansman rope. Might as well jump in the coffin to get shipped up north to Canaan land, hoping someone opened the casket doors. As soon as it opened, they got a cross in your face. Between two slices of bread, pig marrow paste. Sugar down, purple stuff, limbs hurt enough. Not free from slavery, but you're doing dirt for hurting cuffs.
For the record, we in the club. We all brothers and sisters, so we in the club. But we all members of Moor Side Temple. We got this going on.
No, this ain't this. That's not what this movement is about. This is a national movement. The nation is out there. The only reason you're here is your job is to go redeem them.
All right, and we are back. Apologies for that. It's a good thing I was able to quickly resolve this, or we would have been, oh my gosh, we would have had probably gotten an hour and 15 minutes to this broadcast. So apologies to everyone. This is Sister Standing on Law, once again, back at you at 1:30 with your host, Anita Hill and Rob Ryan Beck.
I am here. See, they just give me a kick out all the computer listeners at that point. That's why you did it, 7 minutes into the thing? Because it was only 15 minutes. Yeah, man, that was crazy.
Yes, it was. I'm just happy that I was able to catch it in time and do something about it. So we're back in action, and we're going to do this like we're redoing the show all over again. This week or this month, we have Mother and Son, a United Family. Isn't this a beautiful thing? Last month, you heard from Mother regarding bringing in new energy and laying down the law from two perspectives, one at a birthing facility and the other, a home birth. This month, or today, we bring you the Son, who supported, helped, protected, comforted, took up posts in order to effectuate a safe delivery. Mission accomplished. It's mine. So we have, Cammy. Let me make sure I got the application.
Hey, Annie, can I say this? Before you go there, I'm sorry, I just hit me. You said in order to ensure a safe delivery, right, and that the child is brought home, and that the child is brought home, right, because they protect. Yes, right. We got to add that because a lot
that's
of that is going on in the hospital. They're taking the babies, and it's like, nah, everybody has to be in unity with this. Yeah, I just wanted to add that.
That is correct. And it's about, look, one thing I want to say is the objective is always about mission accomplished. That's all. Mm-hmm. It's not about anybody's ego. It's not about, who's in charge. It's not about any of that. It's about mission accomplished. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so we have Cameo Islam back at us, Cameo Bay.
Islam.
Mm-hmm. And we have a Sim, and William, right?
Islam.
Islam, William, Cameo,
mother.
We grouping now. All right, Annie.
Yeah.
We all needed that regroup, though. Let's face it. Everybody on the line needed that regroup, so we're good. All right. Including me.
I didn't. I was ready to go.
Of course. So proceed.
I would like to do here is to just have the sons, talk about how you prepared. When did you start the preparation? What kind of not to put too much of your business out there. Please remember this is private. What you would advise anyone to do, but speak from in terms of what you did. Think I also want you to point out how important it is for both mother and son to be on the same page, but mother really, she needs to have her voice. And I think in one of the situations, I think because of the support, mother was able to have the voice she needed to have to make sure that things went the way the family wanted it to go. So being that we have two perspectives here, but I know the end result was the same. Who wants to start first?
Islam. Camille Bay, Northwest of Mexico, Pennsylvania, Philadelphia Territory. Before I start, do I have permission from the elders to speak?
Absolutely.
I appreciate it. Then I'll carry on. I'm from my wife, Christina Bay. We did the home birth. And how we went about the things that we did, first we brought it to the family. After she was comfortable bringing it to the family. So by bringing it to the family, we did get the insight on, if anybody wanted to be there to help us out, because it does take a village. We did have people that did say they were going to try to, stay with her overnight and, make sure she had food, make sure they cooked, and made sure they were going to clean up and stuff like that just to give her the extra rest. However, we did follow another way. It was a full moon, and we know what the full moon does to the body, what the full moon does to the water, and if the water is created of if the body is created of water, we know the effects that it takes, the gravitational pull. So we did stand out the night before, and we stood underneath of the full moon. Standing underneath of the full moon actually pulled the baby down. So our thing with our studying, no creature gives birth on their back. It's just unnatural for the baby to come down with grab. So we wanted the universe to be able to pull the baby into the flesh, from the, out of the womb to the flesh.
Well, let me say this. Let me just interject here. What actually was happening with the moon, because it rises the tide in water, it rises the water. It was actually swelling the water, rising the water in her womb until it, it's time to just, it swells enough where it's time to burst. And when that water comes out, then that's what takes the baby down and gives birth to a child. It's really the water swelling in her womb. Time to go.
Absolutely. So, prior to all of this happening, we did discuss that, she wanted to give birth, upright in a vertical position. So she wanted to be in a squatting position. So, we found different ways of methods of doing that. And with the help of, one of my brothers, Kwasim, and my father, Asim, everybody, they was there just to, to comfort and get the support. It happened around 4:30 in the
AM. Can I interject just for a minute?
Absolutely.
Because I don't want people to get the wrong idea. We did have a doula and we did have a midwife. All right. Prior, so when she was impregnated and she knew she was pregnant, she did do her research, and she found a doula, and she found a midwife. And so during her pregnancy, she was in the care of a midwife and a doula, too. So it was prior preparation before it was me and Kwasim involved in it, because we were just the men, the sons. So it was the mother had did some extensive research on her own. So I just wanted to say that so people don't think that we were doing all that.
Absolutely.
Cameo, he just started at that part of the story there. He didn't go into prior. And we think it's important for the family to understand prior things that you should be doing before the baby is even ready to come. So Islam.
I definitely appreciate that. So to pick back up where I left off at, well, we just had different jobs and different things that we said we were going to do. So before the baby came in, we did definitely get it recorded. Quasim had everything recorded. My father, I seen, was in charge of making sure the water was filled, making sure she everything she needed, the ice pack on her neck or if she wanted. He actually decided that he came up with a good idea with her to chew on watermelon in between her contractions, which actually helped her a lot, you know, keeping those fluids inside of her because a lot was coming out of her. And honestly, the birth itself from the time her first contraction, I mean, from the time of the contraction to the time that the baby arrived, took about 45 minutes. And
tell the story.
So when she came in the middle of the night, she had to go to the bathroom. She came back in and she sat down and she said, "Babe, don't get excited, but I think my water broke." Me being a first-time father, you know, and being a law protector, I'm protecting anything, you know. I got to protect the law as she lays the law. And she's saying she, you know, something happened, so I'm jumping up ready to protect. I'm, you know, let me get everything ready. Let me, you know, make sure this interest is cool. She actually had to calm me down. Christina actually calmed me down and said, "Listen, relax." She said, "Sit down for a second. This is about to be an experience." She said, "We need all the energy we can have." The midwife actually explained to her that you're going to be going through a lot, so try to get as much rest as possible. So Christina actually came back, and she laid back down in the bed. And when she laid back down in the bed, she actually had another contraction right there. So she counted herself in between contractions. And it was about 6 minutes apart. So she got up. She said, "You know what, I'm going to just get ready." And since we already talked about recording the whole birth, because we have everything from start to finish recorded, she said, "Let me put my makeup on and let me brush my teeth and that type of thing." Me, I'm telling her, "Man, let's just get down here in this pool just in case." So, you know, contraction hit. I'm helping her come down the steps. And we made our way to the pool. I told Quasim and I told Asim, and everybody got to their positions and started doing everything we already discussed that we were going to do. Got the pool filled up. And I got in the pool, so we were calling the midwife, and the midwife was actually at another birth. So at the same time, another baby was being brought into this world, so she was saying, "I can't stop in the middle of this. But the second this baby comes, I'm going to make sure the baby is good, then I'll be on my way to you guys." Well, baby Justice wasn't trying to hear that. So she got into the water. Another contraction came. In between the contractions, my father went and grabbed the watermelon, and she was chewing on the watermelon. The watermelon actually hydrated her and actually was soothing her. It was taking her mind off of different things, and the chewing effect actually was helping her out, she said. So, you know, the watermelon definitely was good. Also, the midwife was on speakerphone on her way there, you know, just advising me different things about the baby. And again, I jumped a little forward. Prior to, we watched a few, I was forced to watch a few home births on YouTube. And I had to watch, you know, I was forced to. It's not that it was scary. It's just that I wasn't ready for it. It's kind of hard to explain.
You needed to be prepared. That's what you're saying. You needed to be prepared.
Right.
Not shocked.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Because we understand, if you prepared, and you see these things and you know these things, then you'll do these things.
Absolutely. And what happened with that was while she was in a pool, you know, another contraction came, and I was rubbing her lower back, and we were pouring warm water on her, talking to her. And I, you know, she pushed again, and I felt the baby's head. And because of the YouTube and the preparation, I said, babe, the baby is crowning. And she got all excited and said, where? And she turned around, and the baby, honestly, it felt like the baby went from inside my hand right back up. So she had to turn back around and get herself together. I'm sorry?
No, I'm just amazed, like a hiccup.
Okay.
Off, right, and it came back up. Go ahead.
Yeah, and it went right back up, exactly. So what she did, Christina actually said to me, she said, I know the baby's going to come on this push, so be ready. And she turned around, and she grabbed a hold of the side of the pool, and she pushed, and I was saying, here's the baby's here, and we pulled the baby out. Now, I was instructed from prior preparation, when you're giving water birth, to keep the baby fully underneath the water until the whole baby is out, until you have head to toe outside of the baby. And that's because the baby is fully inside of water, inside the mother, and outside the pool, I mean, inside the pool, is still inside of water, so it's just like he's home. So don't be alarmed about him not being able to breathe or anything like that. He's completely natural. He, you know, he's completely fine. So I kept him all the way under, so for about 4 or 5 seconds, and he actually opened his eyes underneath the water, and I saw him open his eyes. So I slowly brung him up above the water, and so baby Justice is his name. I mean, Justice is his appellation. I apologize. He did like a big yawn, opened and started moving all his fingers, and Christina put him into her chest, and she softly started rubbing her back. She was told from the preparation not to spank the baby or not to, you know, knock the mucus out the baby, just softly rub his back, and he'll open up his lungs himself. And that's what he did. After about 2 or 3 rubs, he started gasping for air, and then he, you know, let loose a little whine, and they were inseparable ever since. And also we did a lotus birth. I'm not sure if anyone on the call is familiar with a lotus birth. Lotus birth is where you leave the placenta and the umbilical cord attached to the baby, because the placenta is actually still alive and still pumping, as if the same way a heart pumps blood, the placenta pumps blood. And the placenta pumps the blood into the baby even outside of the womb for about another 12 hours, I believe it does. So they said about 300 more red blood, 300 milliliters of blood cells, red blood cells are still being pumped inside of the baby after the baby is outside the womb. And also with the womb, with the placenta is like the highest technology ever. So when the placenta comes out, any type of virus, if it was just say a virus or any type of, you know, unbalance in the universe, the placenta can sense it, and it puts the antibodies into the baby, so it teaches the baby how to fight it. So that's what the placenta does, and that's why, you know, with our study, and that's why they wanted to cut, that's why they cut the umbilical cord and take the placenta so fast away, because they know that's the gift of the world, that's the actual tree of life. So we kept that, and we had to learn how to, you know, to clean it, how to season it. We used sea salt, I forget a couple other
rosemary.
Things. Rosemary. Yeah, rosemary.
Rosemary, a few herbs. Yeah, a few herbs. Well, this came from the having the midwife and the abdullah there who taught how to prepare the placenta once it came out with the herbs and stuff, and to wrap it in a diaper-like thing.
Silk cloth.
You know, and,
silk cloth.
Right, the cloth, and keep it wet. And what happens is that the baby continues getting the nutrients and things out of the placenta-wise outside the mother. And listen to me, because I just learned these things from Christina and Cameo, accepting the duty and wanting to have the in-home birth. And so we all, as a family, was learning what to do from the midwife and the doula and stuff and all about the placenta and these things. So doing our research and everything before the baby even got here. And so that was the importance of that. And then tell him how long it took before the placenta just fell off and how beautiful his baby is now.
The umbilical cord was still attached. So basically, Christina was nursing. Our son was 100% breastfed. So as he was nursing, she had to carry around the placenta as well because, you know, it's still shooting the blood cells into the baby. So it took about 3 days, about 72 mm-hmm. hours or right under 72 hours before the umbilical cord just fell off itself. And it made a perfect
wow.
navel. I've had people that said they've never seen a navel so, you know, perfect. And it was nice and clean, and the baby didn't even feel it. Like, he didn't even know it came off. So, you know,
that's so cool.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
Mm. Wow.
And with the, we still actually had the placenta. We actually froze it, and our plan is Justice's born day. His solar return is actually on the 20th of this month, so he'll be 1 year. And we're going to plant a tree and plant the placenta. We're trying to do either a pear tree or probably like a pear tree or peach tree, and we're going to plant the placenta underneath of the tree to help the tree get the nutrients to grow.
You know, I just want to say one thing. Ed, I know you want to interject something. I mean, you wanted to comment, but let me just interject it. I meant to ask someone that I know about they I think they mentioned that they kept the placenta frozen just like you did, but they never froze it because you can go back, like you mentioned earlier, the antibodies for that child is in there and all of that, and that if the children have gotten sick, they go back to that and take a piece and do another process or whatever, and that automatically cures that child. So I don't want to really comment on it, because I don't really know. Maybe someone listening can add to that, but I'm still not sure of it. But
I apologize. We just heard the same thing.
Yes.
And the funny
yes,
thing
okay.
is when you hear things like that, you know, of course, those powers that think they be will come out and try to put out stories to confuse people. And
sure.
Now all of a sudden it's turned away from eating the placenta or saving the placenta because it will mold up and viruses will come from it and blood stinks and it will contaminate your other food, so please keep the placenta out of your house and that type of thing. And it's actually been encouraged now.
And that's crazy, too. Because we know what science is doing with the placenta. They use
right.
it in makeup and people putting it all on their face and stuff.
Stem cells.
They put it in foods and
stem cell
research.
They make lipstick.
So to say that, it's ludicrous, you know,
yep.
But they don't want mothers to request that they keep their placentas.
That's right.
And do it because they done made a whole industry out of collecting them.
That's
yes.
right.
Yep.
Nobody's making lipstick.
Right. Also, I forgot to mention, when the midwife did get there, she did weigh Justice, and she did take his blood, and we got his blood type. And with the help of our family and our extended family, the Moorish Nation, we did have our birth record, and we had it signed and by the mother and myself. We also did other things to it, and we had it witnessed and recorded as well. So, you know,
Keeping it within our family.
Right.
Keeping it within our family. All right,
thank
so we don't want people to get misconstrued when they hear certain things recorded, then we can record things within our own family and in our own books.
That's right. In fact, the Bible.
Absolutely.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, we wanted to create our own birth records, and we wanted to have them sealed under our own nation, sealed,
yep.
and being on there those records. Go.
All right, Sister Annie, you wanted to make a comment there. That sounds like you have something you know about there.
No, actually, no. Actually, when he said he clarified the recording, because, and I'm very glad you did that, because, you know, our people, they hear recording, they be like, yep, I'm going to run to the municipal corporation tomorrow and record my stuff. So,
right.
you know, I'm very glad that you, you know, clarified that, because our people always think that they got to go report to municipal corporations about our activity.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that, not to get off topic, but in speaking about that, one of the things that we have to understand as a nation is that we have to, the nation is already built, and what we're doing is rebuilding because it was a fall. And so we have to create our own documents, our own libraries,
mm-hmm.
our own books, our own stories, our own history as a continuation
right.
of what our foremothers and forefathers had already brought us. And we have to keep those documents in a safe place so in 100 years from now, and that's
right.
not far-fetched, because some of us got grandparents or great-grandparents that's still living now that's almost 100
that's
years old and walking.
That's right.
And so that's
we'll
not far fetched to understand that. And so when your children and great-grandchildren, they'd be able to pull up these documents, and these documents is no longer lost or scattered.
Wow, man, you're hitting it, man.
So this is what's important that we have to understand. I mean, not only in the birth and understanding that we have to come together as a family and talk about these things, but the documents and how we document our history now. Because
yes.
if we don't claim this here, you're going to have these pale, modern Europeans walking around in open, plain sight with fez on and garb on saying they Moors.
That's right. That's what
that's right.
Oh,
we
oh, won't
have
it.
No documentation to say that they're not.
But now,
so
okay.
we,
you know, oh, my God, I'm sorry. I'm just like, you are hit. You're hitting it so well because, you know, now what are people's minds? Because they're definitely trying to take that place. Listen, we are really uncovering all of this. There definitely and always have been. It's called birthright theft. It's literally called birthright theft. And so when, like right now, they're trying to say they're Indian or that label Indian, when the truth of the matter is those are Moors who were the natives by description and by existence. Now they want to come in and they blatantly want to be Moors. I want to clear this up real quick. Because some people out there are saying, well, aren't Europeans Moors too? And aren't they? Listen, the key is this. Whatever your mother is, not your father, no disorder, but that is the order. I mean, no disrespect. That is the order of the way, not the day of the way in nature. This is why you have the secrets that we, the truth that they call secrets that they're covering up today into the society called Mason, which is Ma and Son. That's all that there is. So it has to be whatever your mother is. So now we kill all the, you can take that tracking and track back, and you will know, you know, so you don't have to get confused and say, well, you know, they have a European father and a Moabite mother. Well, it doesn't matter. Whatever the mother is, that's what they are. And they can go back to their grandmother and their grandmother and their grandmother, and if they're, whatever they are, that's what you are. And just bring it down the line. But the other thing, and I just want to say, is about the record. This is so important. And Annie, you just hit on it too. You like our people think that they should go and take these records and have them, you know, like you said, 50 years from now, 100 years
file
from now, or whatever.
File the
incorporation of the municipality and stuff like
right.
that. So now you have the birth of your beautiful child that is underwritten by a seal of an inferior corporation, period, at an inferior jurisdiction. What? Think about it for a minute. Now, some people, let me just say, they're thinking, well, you know, what are we going to do? We can't record ourselves. Listen, you get so, you can record it yourself. That's why families recorded it in their bibliothelia text that you call a Bible. It has a tree, a family tree in it. That's what that was for. And to this day, that is still considered an acceptable record, because what we're talking here is a record. That means a recording of something that occurred, not a recording of it and then the authorization on an underwriter of whether how it occurred. You do not do that. And lastly, even today, people who are interested in history, they don't mind when they dig up stuff that's all tattered and tethered and stuff, and, you know, they're trying to read what it says. Those are records. So you're going to be making your records accept that. You're going to have a better presentation of them, and they're definitely not going to be authorized by an inferior family, Islam.
That's right, Islam. And to your point, and I don't want to go on this anymore because we want to still bring you another story, and the story of the sons, is that to your point of the record must reflect, in the way that we put thought into creating the records, is that the record have the bloodline of the mother on it, the birth record, so that the record reflect, and the record have the language of our customary language on it. For instance, of the time of birth, we use the Islamic calendar along with the Julian calendar or the Christian calendar in parentheses. But the months of the Islamic month, the time, for instance, Justice was born in the month of Sawat. And Kyrie was born in the month of Ramadan, you know, and so the record reflects that of our customary forefathers and foremothers, you know, and so we find that this is important for the record also, and that it have El Madrid of Oxa and Northwest of Mexico. These things of our are on these records.
And be truthful, if it doesn't have the record, like you said, of the mother, it's like, not that we're ships, but it's a vessel, it's a liking to, because a lot of people, you know, they want to go that way. It's like it's to a ship without a flag. You understand?
Right.
No national flag. It's lost.
Understood.
So people, right, so now people try to effectuate that in a commercial way, when I'm not saying it in a commercial way. I'm saying it in a way
that's
that,
right,
as you said, the nation is already here because it's in the womb of the eggs, in the womb of every sister. It's a, like you said earlier, like, you know, we're not making a nation, and I hadn't experienced the same thing. And then the Seven Principles book, I said, look, I was asked, do I want to create a nation or build a nation? And I think, wait a minute, the nation's already here. It's to rebuild it or to strengthen it is what important is,
right,
what needs to occur. That's what needs to occur. And in order to do that, you have to study to have knowledge on how on what we need to impart and know. So, you know, without the mother, like the mother flag, without the mother, which is the national indication, you know, flag, it doesn't mean anything. So if they find it, and they find it later, and it's underwritten by some corporation, it's, they know that this was not a natural birth. I don't care if you sit right there. And brother, on the line, what's the brother that, I'm sorry, my mind.
William.
Said, who?
You said William? Or the
William,
one that was
William.
There to
okay.
Record.
All right. Yes. You're telling all this stuff about what you experienced. That's natural birth, right? So
yes.
What happened
from
is
cameo,
all
yeah.
that, the cameo did, yes. All that natural birth means nothing because it gets recorded as something else. You understand? And
right.
underwritten.
Right. Right.
This is important.
So, but we don't
want to
confuse everybody on the call. You're absolutely right. Islam. And you held the baby too, Rod. So, you know.
Justin?
You know. Yes. Yeah,
Justin is a beautiful spirit. Justice is a beautiful, like you, wow. It's so innocent when children come in, you know. And I would suggest at this point, And I guess we should move on, but I would suggest at this point to explain what I'm saying. Read chapter 23 of the Circle 7 Holy Quran, and it tells you the duties you know, as being a mother and father, or what they say, parents of the child.
Right.
This child is a child of their own. Khalil Gibran says the same thing. He said, that child, Camille, that child belongs, came through mother, came through her, but belongs not to her. So the duty and obligation that the two have and the family has is a duty and obligation. But that spirit, man, that mind, justice is a mind, is man. It's a mind that is manifest in the flesh. So she just brought in the law, and he, this is the generation of the spirit of children. He is beautiful in his spirit. All children are innocent in his spirit for the most part anyway. And you may have, that baby is just grateful. And I will say this, a single daddy. He has all the family in it. I saw your eyes. He has the light eyes. And stuff. So, you know, he looked like you, Grande.
Yes.
And right. But I just want to say to everyone that the child cameo was talking about, I did get to hold that child. I have a photo with him and everything. Thanks for sending a beautiful baby.
Yes.
Beautiful
spirit. I appreciate it. Definitely appreciate it. Definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow. So we do want William to speak for
William.
All right. And I'm sorry, William, to cut you off before that, just to know, again, without my wife's permission with any of this, none of this would have went on. Because, again, the mother, the elves make the law. The babes just protect, you know, are the law protectors. And my duty was to protect everything that was going to go on with whatever decision she chose. Islam.
Thank you.
Islam.
Thanks for that. That is the duty that is your duty. The duty of all sons is to enforce the law. Mother lays it down, he enforces it. No arguments, no debates, that's how it goes. And when we get to the fundamental of this, the natural part of it, we will not have the issues that we have now, which are based in an infiltration of a different mindset. So we got to go back to the mindset of our ancient foremothers and fathers, and we'll solve all of our problems.
All righty. And with that, I believe Brother William, or most noble son, William Bay.
Mm-hmm. Well, I am. That's Will I Am. Will I Am on the line.
We can't hear you, Will.
You muted.
Oh, just a minute. I'm going to give him my headset.
Okay.
Oh, all right.
Islam, while they're in the middle of doing
there you are. There you are. Well, I just want to tell you, we introduced you as Will. I don't know if you heard it. We said, Brother William, right? We said, Will I Am is on the line. It's live.
No, you still not on the line.
Yeah, he's not on the line.
Can you guys hear him?
No.
They can hear him?
Not
no, we
nobody
can
hear you. Hey, use my headset. Islam, is that better?
Well, what can you hear
you
now?
Yeah.
Will I Am? Yes.
Yes.
Oh,
our situation.
But you got a background, the echo. We can hear us talking. Okay, that is now it's gone. Go ahead.
Our situation was a little bit different. Cameo is my little brother. So he, after Christina had the baby, naturally at home, that was going to be our plan. That was our plan. That's what we had talked about doing. So when Shante got pregnant, that was our plan. We're going to have a home birth, and if not a home birth, to have the baby in a birthing center, we didn't want to involve the hospitals in any way. So when Shante went to her first appointment with the OB, she let the OB know, listen, I'm thinking about having a home birth. That's my plan. So as soon as she said that, the questions came, well, why do you want to do that? I don't know if it's safe.
Money.
He better.
That's all they saw was money going out the window. That's all they saw.
Exactly. Exactly. So, you should have it at the hospital. I don't know. This, that, and the third. So, they gave her these tests, and then they came up with, oh, well, your sugar is too high. We're going to start testing your sugar monthly, weekly, keep coming back for these tests for your sugar because your sugar is too high. So when we was going and researching to have the at the birthing centers, once we, you know, told them that the doctor said things about the glucose, they was very apprehensive about allowing us to do that. So they said, well, once you, the doctor said that, then we can't have you, we can't, we're not going to be able to let you have the baby here at the couple different birth centers that we had went to. So we had another conversation. We figured, hey, it was, we just would do it through the hospital. After we had that conversation, we was like, well, this is what's going to happen. We're going to tell them, listen, we want to have the baby this way, and that even though we're having the baby in the hospital, we're not going to be signing no papers. He won't be having no Social Security number, no birth certificate or anything like of that nature. That's what the plan is. That's how it's going to happen. That's what we're doing. So that was 2 or 3 months into her pregnancy. So 6 months before we had, 6 or 7 months before we had to go to the hospital, that was our plan. So fast forward to the night of the birth, you know, she had the baby, and they took the blood, they did everything they needed to do, and then they come and they say, well, we had this paper for you so you can sign the birth certificate. Oh, let me back up a little bit, because I went to a lot of the appointments, and they ignore the father. They only speak to the mother. So you there for support, and that's it. Like, they're not asking you for your input. They're not asking you how you're feeling. They're not asking you what you see in the mother. They're not talking to you. It's like you don't exist in that room. They talking to the mother and the mother only about whatever is happening, and they not doing nothing without her consent. They make sure she's signing. They don't care about if you have a conversation with her, none of that. They only talking to the mother. At every appointment, even at the hospital, me standing next to her as she's giving birth, they not, it's like I don't exist unless I'm in their way. Excuse me, out my way. So I felt that's something that I kind of knew in my head. But to actually experience it and see it is like, oh, okay, you know. So to go, so she had the baby, they cleaned it up, brought it to us, and they said, well, we got this paper, we want you to sign the birth certificate. And so Shante says, no, we're going to choose not to do that. We're not doing that. And they're like, well, you know, the baby's not going to be able to get no Social Security or Medicaid or any assistance, just getting a third if you don't sign it. So she says, yeah, I understand that. We don't want to, we're choosing not to do that. She said, oh, okay. You know, and to think about it now, with the president as the president, they might not have the Medicaid anyway, to be honest. So, but
they don't, they're not, and they won't.
So we said we're choosing not to do that. So that's the night of. The next night, my parents come up, and they say, well, Sean said, you're clear to go home, but we want to keep the baby for another night. So, you know, I see your family is here. Your family can take you home if they want to take you home. But the baby, we're going to keep the baby here for, you know, another night just to make sure we'll do some observations, this, that, and the third. So she was adamant about, no, where my baby is at, that's where I'm going to be at. So if you won't keep the baby another night, then I'll stay here another night. And so she stayed the next night. So the next morning we came up. It's me, my father, and my little cousin, who's a teenager. And we came up and we said, hey, we taking the baby home. And they sent about 3 or 4 different people. Oh, everything is all right. All these tests, you good. You could take the SIP. I heard you had some questions about the Social Security. I heard you had some questions about signing the birth certificate. So, no, we don't have no questions about signing the birth certificate. We're pretty aware of what's going on. We're choosing not to do so. I said, are you sure you want to do that? I kind of think you might have to sign. And they were very cautious about the words they used when they was speaking to us about that birth certificate. So he's like, no, we don't want to do that. I say, okay, well, hold on. We got to make some phone calls and see the stat of the third. So they try to coerce and influence you and make you feel like you are, what's the word I want to use? Like they threaten you to do these things for whatever reason. And
coercion. They start out with coercion, mm-hmm. and then if they think they mm-hmm. can, they'll use threat. Only if they think that the person you're talking to will respond to their fictitious threat or whatever like that. But people like yourself, they knew that you weren't responding to it because you knew that you didn't need it. But the real reason is that, I mean, the real thing that they sense is that not only did you know you didn't need it, you knew why you didn't need it, and you didn't have to have that discussion with them because it doesn't matter. You don't need to tell them all of that. You just need to be sure in your footing what it is you're doing, and they saw that. Most people are not, and they start talking, well, I don't know, the birth certificate and all this stuff like that, and then they realize this is a weak person, and they can probably pierce their veil because if they were smart, if they really knew what they were doing, they wouldn't have those types of conversations. They would just stick straight to their position, take their position, and stick to it, Islam.
Well, it's fine. Absolutely. And I think that, you know, the temperament that you have going into that situation and why it's important to have those conversations with your family members, why it's important to have the conversation with the mother when you go in is really important to know that you're not getting into all of that. You know, you already had that conversation. You already had that discussion. This is what we're going in there to do. This is what we're going in there to accomplish, and we don't need to have no extra conversation about it. Are you signing this paper? No, we choosing not to do that. Hold on one second.
And I just want to say what our audience listening is that the rest portion, I was just thinking, he was saying, you don't know how to express what it is, but there's coercion, there's threat, and then this thing called duress. Well, that's not something you would actually put your finger on because it is a sensation, and that's what they do. They appeal to your feelings and your, causes you a sensation or an emotion. That's what duress is. Duress is a sensation or state of mind that they end up putting you in. Islam.
What we want to do also, because I'm a storyteller, right? And so I need to make things vivid. You know, and my sons are there learning that. But I need to make things more vivid also for the family to understand. When my son said your presence, all right, understand, we wearing our fez, we in garb, and before going up there, not only do we talk on the plane of the flesh, we have discussions about the spirit. Because your spirit has to be right when you want to be approaching these people
right.
around you. So we talk also on that level also for the preparation, especially for the family out there for something as wonderful in America as the a child, another spirit coming into the world. So we want to be conscious around the new spirit coming in the world, so it come in around more or less conscious people. But part of the preparation, though, is on the spirit level also, talking about that, knowing who you are. So, and the, what makes that so important is this. You don't have to go up there talking about I'm a Moorish American and I have this right and it's this and you can't tell me. And it's, you don't have to get into all that. Understand, we went up there understanding the Constitution and our constitutional right, our religious right, because part of the question is why you don't want to do this here. And what we wanted to put on the record is because of our religion. Boom, period.
Bingo.
So we don't want to go no further and all that and this and that with the Moors, right? Anything beyond that, you know it's going to be a lawsuit. You know it's going to be a problem. So we go
That's
up there
right.
with that. And so to stop a lot of the onslaught of the questioning and sending a whole lot of more different people in there. So that has to be understood, the mental, because my man is mine. So the mental state of mind of the mother, the father, and obviously the child, because the child is there hearing and this affecting this here. Also, don't think because, you know, it's a newborn baby, that spirit is hearing this here. The spirit is involved and the ancestors involved. So we had to, in our conversations, when both of my sons talked about getting the family involved, we go in on that level. Understanding that level, you know, the level, the flesh of what's going on. And the concept of going into the hospital was this. This is a corporation which provides a service of delivering babies. Just like you go into Walmart or somewhere, one of these corporations provides a service of selling food. You go get the food that you want or the service you want. You go to the checkout counter, you pay for it, and you leave. That's the concept we went in with. So it's a hospital corporation providing the service of helping to deliver the baby, and that's what we want to pay for, and not all the other adhesion contracts and those type of things there. So that's the mindset of going in there. So we didn't want to get in there and be talking about the state and Social Security, and we know what they do, and
the Treaty of Peace and Friendship.
Right.
None
we
of that.
Didn't want to go into all that.
But
you
did
know.
You notice? But did you notice that that's what they used at first, and then Williams said they were very careful. But that's what they used at first. Well, don't you want them to have Social Security? Don't you want them to get a driver's license? You know, they use that because
right.
they think that's what is about for us. So I just wanted to bring that point out. Yeah.
Right. Absolutely. So, and for me personally, I've come to find out that in any walk of any life, any profession you have, anything that how prepared you are for it is how calm you be in it. You know, if you have a speaking engagement, you go and you talk and you had it and you talk in the mirror to yourself and you make yourself more comfortable with it. You know, if you have a test coming up, you studying for the test. So when the tests come and these questions come, you're like, oh, I know this, and you just breezing through the test. So it's the same thing in these situations. We go through it, and my dad might have a mock situation where he's the doctor and he's asking us questions, and how we responded to the questions
yeah,
calmly as possible, you know, to make sure that when we get into these situations that we staying on task and we have a goal and that's it. We're not trying to veer away from none of that.
The goal is to leave here with the baby.
Yeah, and that's our goal. Our goal is to leave with the baby. You know, that's what we was doing and that's what we're here for, and that's it. And my role in that is just to be the support in that. You know, like I said, they don't really talk to the men in the room. They only try to talk to the mother. So we had it. Listen, this is what we want to do. You know, that's what we're trying to do. And
because
they try their best. Go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
They try their best to try to separate you, you know, try to have her walk in the hallway to have a conversation with her. They try to call her on the phone and talk to her, you know, and so that it's just them and her by herself, but not at no point was we allowing her to be by herself. She knew that she had the support.
Beautiful. And Musty worked. Go ahead.
I made sure that, you know, she had our support in that, but I wasn't trying to take control or nothing like that. I was just there. So, you know, as a presence, if she felt nervous about anything, she had somebody. But she was a champion in that, and she was very aware. She was very steady, so she knew what she was trying to do too. So it was yes and no, and this is what we're trying to do. So, you know, they had us waiting around for hours, not telling us what's going on, just having different people come in and asking us questions, and we weren't trying to hear none of that. You know, go ahead.
No, I just said that's interesting. Go ahead. Break her down.
Absolutely, and they finally, at a point, they brought a lady chaplain I wasn't really aware of how this thing worked, but, you know, she walked in the room apparently to pray over the baby.
What?
She walks in the room. She walks in the room, and she has, like, you know, this big dress on, and she has around her neck a big cross around her neck. And the way room is set up, it's a little corridor before the room. So she walks through the corridor. The curtain was kind of closed, and my father was standing behind the curtain. And like I said, like he said, you know, he had his garb on, he had his fez on, and he had a necklace on himself. So the way that they kind of met, you know, he walked around the corner as she's walking up the corridor, and it just stopped her energy right there at the door, you know.
Yeah.
Right at the door, and she didn't take another step into the room.
So she didn't come in and so-called bless the child. She didn't.
No, she came right to the door, and she changed.
Turned around
as soon as she saw my father, she saw my dad.
Yeah.
Her
whole
tune changed. Oh, is everything all right? I was just in here to make sure things was okay.
Yeah, right, right. They was trying to put a spell, a curse, what they call a bless the baby. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Under the Christian tenets. This is very, I didn't know this, this is very, very, very important. Because, I mean, first of all, you want to tell her this is a great time. I think you put it out already. Who and what hospitals are under, because they are all Christian institutions coming from
the
municipalities.
All these institutions that they call hospitals, they are established by the municipal corporation. And as you all know, because they did the research on the Philadelphia Corporation, many of these corporations, we're calling them corporations today, but many of them were established as religious colonies.
Mm-hmm.
And you can look at, and you know that's what it lets you know. In the book that we've been reading, these are religious colonies. So, you know, but they're religious colonies under the various, nation states. I think Valera calls them. So the nation state, which is still another corporation, that many of them are under in Great Britain. So their religious you got to understand that, you know, this is a war between mother and daughter, but they come guised as a lot of different things. So, you know, what's crazy is you got all these people writing to the Pope like the Pope is the mother and the father. This is a war between mother, the Asiatic mother, and European daughter. That's it. But they come, guys, in many forms, and one of them is religious wars.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, this is interesting. I don't understand what a Christian priest would have to do with the position that you guys are taking at all.
Absolutely. And when, like I said, when she walked in and my dad turned that corner, it's like, it was like two
opposite
energies. Yeah, two opposing energies is like hit each other. And after that, I didn't really see it at first, but my dad was like, he told me it took all the energy out of him. And he had to sit down for a couple minutes to gather himself from that, you know, confrontation. You know, she left right out the room after that. She just, oh, everything is all right. Okay, thank you. And she just left right out the room after that. And he sat down and he's like, man, did y'all just notice that? And he's sitting down catching his breath. And I'm like, yeah, you all right? He's like, yeah. But that was deep, you know.
That's
and,
the wall.
So,
That's it. That is so powerful, this experience right here.
Mm-hmm.
But so, I just want to interject something right here because, you know, this is the power of family. And now let me just say this because these are what Europeans classify as biological family members, but we're all biological family members. All right. So what I'm trying to say is we as a people, as a family, we need to, you know, be supportive of each other. Now, I recognize that sometimes people might not be wanting to take a stand, you know, like they don't want to get in the battle, but you can take up posts. And see, this is what mothers need. It ain't got nothing to do with if you think you're the baby daddy, because you're not. This is all about getting the mothers in, if that's the route they're going to choose, and getting them out. So if you know of a mother who is pregnant and she's going to be going into the institution, the one thing you should ask her is, do she need any mufti to take up post? You know, and if she's conscious, you know, she should say, why, yes, I do.
Absolutely. Nothing like that spirit. Right. You know, if she's conscious, she would say, absolutely. Right, you're right.
Yeah.
Not like that feeling of the son protecting, if I may just interject real quick. It's nothing like that feeling. I remember when I had my office, this is before I was even conscious, but I knew about the Nation of Islam because I was in a community. I had a community newspaper, and they would use my conference room for some of their meetings or whatever. Anyway, long story short, they were there using it on a Saturday, and I came in to do work. And, I mean, there was a brother posted at the front door, a brother posted at the back door, a brother when they came inside, he says, who are you here to see? And if I was in my office, they would direct me to my office. Nothing like that. That means they're on post. They don't have to say anything.
Exactly.
Just be there.
That's right.
Yeah. That energy they got.
That's
be
right.
There.
That's what you're supposed to be effectuating in this Moorish nation. And I want to just say it one more time. This don't have jack to do with you thinking, oh, I'm the baby daddy and that's my baby. So because of that, I'm going to take a post. No, wrong mental thinking. You take a post if any mother is going in there, and you make yourself available to your fellow brethren if the mother of the child is coming in is going into that institution. This, you know, we can take a page. We really can't take a page from the Nation of Islam, but they don't go in on no onesie twosie. They go in with full protection. Usually it's for the son, but hey, we need to be doing that for the mother.
Yeah, the Woman March proved that part, but you know they was all out for the son. But we got to get it back because the Million Woman March, they wasn't out the same way. sorry if somebody else was saying something. I'll just...
No, continue.
Oh, and then, oh, okay.
Right.
So after that energy, so we had been in the hospital for, you know, a few hours at this point, so I was getting kind of restless, and I was wanting to go home, so I had a conversation with my dad, like, why are we even here still? Like, what can they even do if we leave? And he said, well, calm down. And the next nurse that came in, my dad asked her, you know, do people leave? You know, do people get up and leave? And she said, yeah, people get up and they leave the hospital all the time. But what happens is they just get bills and they have, you know, these huge bills that the insurance doesn't cover.
So you're saying they're extending your time there so that they can increase the amount of the bill. So if you just leave and it's like clocking out, like you left and they didn't know you left, so they can send you to bill you for time. And I was gonna say it's like they're holding on, either try to break you down and or try to get any more finance, and you just kind of lose it, like you're still on the clock. Oh, we didn't know you left.
Right. And they were trying to get to, I guess, the financial responsibility, who's going to take care, since y'all not signing these forms, signing the baby over to us, then who's going to be the financial responsibility of this birth that we just had? So,
well, that's their training. That's their training. You showed us listening that. That's another thing. They're so used to people doing it this way, this way, this way, this way. That was their training that, oh, you're not signing it. Uh-oh, what do we do now? Because by you signing this, it allows us to do this, do some adhesions down here.
Right.
Everybody gets paid. Now they're stuck. All right, peace. Wow,
right.
Wonderful.
So what we end up having to do is, you know, they gave us a bill, and I gave them like $10, $20, signed it, and they were like, all right, well, fine. They allowed us to go. So that was after about 3 or 4 hours we was there. I think we got there about 9, and we left about 1 o'clock.
I want to say it's important. They didn't allow us to go. This is also important. So they didn't allow us to go. We had told them, listen, if there's no more to do here, we're leaving. And then they hurried up and scrambled around. And, you know, made a phone call, said, okay, we're not making a birth certificate. Or they said that they was doing something but not putting no name on it and this and that. And the mother's thing was, listen, I'm not signing nothing and I'm not doing this here, so whatever y'all have to do is it, but we're done. And so after that conversation, a wheelchair came to the door ready to escort us out to the hospital. That's how that ended. So what I want to conclude and make it and get a point across to the family is this, especially young brothers and sisters, especially young mothers, take your position. Communicate with your significant other if it's communicable. Plan out your situation because you are creators of your own reality. Plan out your situation ahead of time. Plan A, B, C. In other words, if you want to have it at home, because I want to tell you, sometimes the home birth might don't work out, and it can be complications where you have to go to one of the institutions for help. That's fine. Understand that. But let that be plan B or plan C so that you understand and be comfortable with what's going on there, you know, and let everybody be a part of that plan so that the brothers or the sons understand plan A, B, and C, that, okay, we got to get her to the hospital. If an emergency people have to come and get her, we jumping in the car and we following them, and we going to be at the hospital, and we going to be there. also. So preparation, preparation, preparation. Other words, study, study, study. Same thing. Islam.
No flying by the seat of your pen, in other words.
Absolutely. It's too important. It is too important. You're bringing another spirit into the world. You know, you're a representative of your forefathers and foremothers, a civilization. Bring those people took on those responsibilities. Act like that. Not this last minute stuff and, you know, these things and I didn't know. Be conscious of these things. You know, it's very important, especially for more in your presentation when you walk up in these places. You prepare. Mm-hmm. It's very important to understand this here, family. Be prepared. And some mores is becoming conscious and maybe your parents aren't with it yet. They don't understand yet. And try and reach out. Try and reach out, you know, to some other sisters. I would say this. As a result of Christina having a successful in-home birth, she's deciding to become a midwife.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, see?
So
yeah.
That'll be somebody that you can reach out to in the future. You can reach mm-hmm. out to her now,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
and talk with her. You know, and brothers out there, you can reach out to us now and talk to us. You know, this is a service we want to offer to the community. So use us,
yes.
but get this in. Use us, but don't misuse us. Don't abuse us.
That's right.
You know, let's understand that, brothers, when we giving this call to so that you can reach out, don't abuse it. Islam. I want to yield and let some other people have families. I mean, some callers have some questions or some things like that. We'll stay on the phone.
Before we kind of wrapped it up where, you know, this is about being prepared. And of course, I got some background noise. Baby's crying. Baby wants to be on the call too.
Yeah, like, hey, I got something to say.
I want you to touch on, I mean, because I want it to be very clear to everyone. This is the mother's decision. The ball is in her court. I don't care what you think that baby came from, the ball is in her court. And I want you to kind of touch on how important the unity of the mother and the son is so that, you know, the mission can be successful. I know you kind of touched on it, but I just want to kind of reiterate it because if the mother and the son is not united, if they're not of one mind, and if he is not clear that he's supporting her, as she brings in her eggs, this is not going to work out well. So can you elaborate on that a little bit?
And if Tim's going to elaborate on that, and I just want to say this. I heard you earlier say, listen, I just want to tell this story. I'm a good storyteller and whatever like that. But you also have to put into it that you're also seasoned. You know, you've had these experiences. Your sons that are expressing what they see are from their firsthand experience right now, whereas you are seasoned. This is why we respect our elders, and all they really can do is tell us the story. Because it's our experience. So we wanted to say that, I wanted to add that it's not just that you're a vivid storyteller, it's because you also are seasoned with life a little bit. So it's like.
Yes, accept it, and understood.
One last thing I want to make a point of, it is imperative, because I know I see a lot of sons come to the class. I don't never see they mate with them. So, that tells me that if she ain't at class learning, she don't know. If she doesn't know,
she can't be prepared.
That's
right. She can't be prepared. Right? And so what's going to end up happening is there's a strong chance that that child will get kidnapped as soon as the baby leaves her womb because she's not prepared. Because whether the son wants to recognize it or not, he's not relevant when it comes to that egg. And so the one that's got to have the voice is the one they're going to be paying attention to, and that is the mother. She can't have a voice. She don't know anything. She can't be, you know, at home, you know, making soap or cooking and cleaning and doing all of these little girly stuff while he's in the class getting the information, because she's the one that they're going to be coming to test. And if she fails, they're going to take that baby.
Oh, that's right. Absolutely. So, to your point, well, thank you for that, Roz. I accept that, and I appreciate that.
You're welcome.
But it's very important for the son and the mother to be on the same page. First of all, it's strength in numbers. Second of all, it won't be no confusion, because they understand divide and conquer, all right? So the son has to understand. Like, I talk to a lot of young brothers. I've even mentored a lot of young brothers in the past. And in the beginning, the young brother has this thing about respect, If he's not talking to me, you know, they disrespecting me and this and that, to be bigger than that. You have to understand that this thing, you bigger than that. That's not totally what disrespect is, all right? Understand your lane, understand your position, and stay in it, stay focused, and let that be it. It's very important to understand that, because you start arguing on the mother's behalf when you're in a situation where they're only dealing with the mother. They're going to take it that you're being confrontational.
Confrontational.
All right. Yes. All right. So you have to understand your role in this here thing, and know. And the mother needs to know, okay, all you have to do is look at the father. After you state your piece, you and the son is on the same page and you say no, then look at the father. These are just things that we found is helpful in your gestures. And I don't want to sit on the line and build with a lot of strategies and things like that. On the phone line. But these are just simple things. You know, for instance, if you're going out and buying a car and you're the family member and you there and the sister want to buy a car and they want the male there with her and you there with the finance and stuff like that and the car dealer, he's trying to haggle the sister and then she's standing on her square. And so she tell the car dealer one thing. This is one of the things that me and my wife practice. You know, you say what you want to say, and then you be quiet. And when he asks another question, you just sit there and look at me. Turn your head, actually look at me, and so that he see that you're looking at me and that we are on the same page. I don't even have to open my mouth no more. You don't even have to open your mouth no more, and then you just turn back and look at him, and then goes to the next question. You know, these is just little things, but you must be on the same page and in the same spirit and walking in the same spirit, all right, because that's what protects you. That's another form of protection. There's a whole lot of forms of protection that as we study, we come to realize that we have to come back out here and joining together with your mate and walking in sync in the spirit with your mate is another form of protection. Understand that, you know, and it gives the mother a tremendous amount of force, you know, when she talk with that, just knowing that you there and you ain't moving off your square, you know, and it's just the nod of your head, the blink of your eyes. Okay, listen, you're right. Mother, you're right. Sweetheart, you're right. You're right in what you're saying, you know, and let her hear that. Let her know that. Don't just take it for granted, you know. Give her that verbal vibration. Yeah, you know that. Yeah. So we in this thing together, and if you see her getting upset and stuff, because they will bombard, they will keep coming and keep coming. Let her just step forward. Take another step forward, you know, between her or next to the person. Don't intimidate the person that they're asking her the question. Just take another step forward, you know, in the conversation. You might be standing in the background of the mother. Take another step forward. You're projecting another energy force. But these are just other things you understand. The point is you must be on the same page and walking in the same spirit, Islam. I've seen something that was interesting this past evening on PBS, on the World Show. And because I come from another school of thought before I came in conscious with the Moorish Divine and National Movement. What I've seen is over in China, I never knew this, but I've been talking with Nate and Eid about this here. But over in China, what I've seen is that it's mosque, Islamic mosque in China, and it's about 34 of them across China, where they're women mosques and women imams who and it's the only place in the world that you see that. And they're spreading, letting you know that the men is in full support of that. It's some men that's conscious now and in full support of that, all right? And so I just wanted to, because I thought that was real strong. That was real strong in the Islamic El-Islam. I wanted El-Islam for those that I want to differentiate, you know, and El-Islam, that's a real, I thought that was a real strong movement and a real strong step by sisters. Even here, you know, I haven't visited a lot of Moorish science temples, but even here, I would think that you would see some women grand sheiks who would be head of some of these temples. I don't know if there's any or not, but that's what came to mind there in this whole thing of supporting our women, because I know from the school of thought that I come from, you know, and Elijah Muhammad and Farrakhan, and I've been through Sunni and Shia. Schools of thought, all right? And one of the things we used to say is that a nation can rise as only as high as its women. And so that had to be understood. And also one of the sayings was that you haven't met an enemy yet until you met one who rises up out of your kitchen. So a woman can be definitely a formidable adversary. But just to say that also. So I hope that came across in that, in answering that question, from my perspective and our family perspective and what we're teaching in our family, you know, because government starts first with family, and so is our individual family, and that includes my sons, my nieces, my nephews, and so forth. And we have other people now who's coming into the family, but that's what we teach, you know.
Yeah.
And we want to get across Islam.
Islam, and you're also saying that and we know this to be true, is that no nation will ever rise any higher than the women.
And that's right. That's what I'm saying.
He pointed to that as well when he said, listen, you got to have a greater respect for womanhood. And so I want to say this. It's sort of like a sum up, but not really. Talking about from birth to navigation on this earth. Listen, after the child navigate in the seven stages of development in the waters of the mother's womb, it is then cut from the navel and becomes a navigating L on this earth plane. That's the way it goes. So you keep a record of who you brought in, who manifests from the spirit man to the flesh, manifested in the flesh. And that is family records. And then, as you said before, we're all biologically, we are all connected. So this is what this is about, you know, true national principles. You know, and I say that because I say that from this conversation, as well as I recently just got an email with someone saying, do I take my papers and my nationality card and go put it on the record at the municipality and demand that they X-rail? And I just said, absolutely not. See, we have the wrong concepts of what this is. That's wrong.
Evidence
of mental
enslavement.
Exactly.
That's right. It's another way of handling those situations with these municipalities. Let that be understood without doing that. So, Islam, is there any other questions? Or?
Let's see. Well, we touched on the unity of the mother and the son, how it is imperative. Also, another imperative point is being prepared. Don't wait until the last minute to plan. The moment she knows that she's pregnant, actually, to be honest with you, planning is supposed to begin before she gets pregnant. That's
right.
Really how we did it. That's how we used to do it. And let me tell you how to be an ill. She should be bringing forth or laying down the law, then her diet has to change, ought to change. I'm not saying it must. Her diet ought to change to accommodate the bringing in of the new energy. And, you know, a good rule of thumb is that that change must take place a minimum of a year before she conceives. Now, I know we're all in catch-up mode, so you just do the best that you can with the information that you have. But I know for a fact that many of the challenges that mothers are having today with their children and, you know, birthing, bringing forth, and even after birth is as a direct the child not receiving the necessary nutrients because the mother didn't have it. And it's not just about building, you know, a great body in terms of the baby. What comes with that when you're eating the right food is a more harmonious child, a child that has rest fits and tempers and less susceptible to negativity. And so what I'm saying is when those things are in place, that being has more of a chance of completing their life purpose. Saying they won't, I'm saying it makes it easier So we have to start doing a lot more pre-planning as opposed to planning once the event happens, and we got to totally eliminate this flying by the seat of your pants thing.
That's right.
Got to totally eliminate that. No mother should ever be alone without another sister when she is having a child. There should be another sister, a family members around. This is supposed to be a joyous event. You're supposed to celebrate it with family. It's not supposed to be just her or her and her mate. Joyous event. So we need to be better prepared for that.
Yes. I think that's I think that's another class that you might want to have, because what happened with Christine, Christine had a situation a year or so prior to that, and as a result of that situation, she prepared. She felt that she had to prepare her body better, and so she changed her diet because she wanted to be with child. So she changed her diet, like you're saying, even a year before, because she knew she wanted to breastfeed, and whatever's in the mother's going to go into the baby. So if you eat a cheesesteak, if you eat a cheesesteak that night, within 2 days, and you the baby is suckling, the baby is eating cheesesteak. Understand that, you know, and
that's
so yeah, that's another class.
And I just
want to
interject something. You know what? That and we might very well do that on a future Sister Standing on Law. Now let me just say this, because I know a lot of they've been mentally conditioned not to breastfeed, or they've been discouraged, or maybe they don't know nobody who breastfeeds, or, you know, I don't know what the issue is, but I'm going to tell you right now. Breastfeeding is the normal and natural way of feeding the baby. This formula that they have out there, that is a bunch of chemicals. Read the ingredients. It is a bunch of chemicals. That's number one. Number two, as we're talking about whatever the mother eats, the baby is eating. I remember when I had my children, they used to give you a list of certain foods to be mindful of because you're breastfeeding, and those foods, they have, you know, their speculation was that for the night, cause the baby to have more wind than normal, you know, so they told you be mindful of these things. They don't do that anymore because, number one, they ain't trying to promote good, healthy children, because good, healthy children, you know, have good, healthy minds. And if you have a good, healthy mind, it's a lot harder to trick you. So they're not promoting good, healthy diets. You know? And then, you know, they have all of these, you know, people who are watching all of these reality shows with these jacked up, mentally twisted sisters who don't want to breastfeed their baby because it's going to, you know, make their bodies look away. That's just stupid and hype. It's stupid.
Oh, yeah.
But
absolutely.
It's also hype.
Absolutely. Now,
can I
never
walk
no,
with
no.
you one part? One thing that they did say to Christina, well, Christina ended up researching and finding out that wherever the baby needs, the mother will produce. So this new theory that, oh, you're not pumping enough or you're not producing enough milk, that's bogus. Whatever the baby needs, the mother will produce. That's why in the middle of the night when the baby cries, the mother lactates. So you don't to get discouraged, because a lot of people get discouraged and say, well, I'm not producing enough milk. I need to go to formula, make sure my baby is fed. No, you know, the Most High definitely made your body to whatever that baby needs, and whenever the baby needs it, the mother will produce it, no matter what.
That is correct.
You know, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Go ahead.
I just wanted to interject what he said. He said, you know, they'll think, oh, you know, I'm not producing enough. But there is a process that once the child wants more milk, the body actually begins to produce more for him. But they'll stop and say, oh, I don't have enough. Just give it a second. Believe me, it will begin by, it's like, you know that thing called supply and demand? Well, it's demand. Mm-hmm. It's actually demand and supply. If the child is demanding more, the mother will make more. Just follow the flow. And also, here's another example of how this information is so important, because there are young sisters who don't know that the first thing that comes out is that clear, it's called colostrum, which are antibodies to protect the child
right.
first, and then comes the milk. You know how many sisters think that, you know, they, oh my gosh, I'm not producing milk, because they don't know that one simple fact. So this is why this is so important to pass this on to
right.
the family.
To that point, the children haven't received no vaccinations, none of those shots,
Let me just say this. I'm so glad you said that, because this is what everybody needs to know. All of those vaccinations, first of all, that's a whole money-making scam. You got to know that, number one. Number two, whatever immunity the mother has, if she's breastfeeding, she's going to pass it on to the baby, so the baby doesn't need immunization because he got it from the milk. But they don't want, like I said, they're trying to discourage women, mothers, from breastfeeding, because if you don't breastfeed your child, then your child will be susceptible to various, you know, viruses and that are in that could very well be airborne. And, you know, and this is why we ought not to have our children in these institutions, because once your child goes to these institutions, they call food, they pick up all kinds of viruses from other children. So, you know, stuff that's not even normal to our species of humans. So, you know, it would behoove us as a nation, mothers taking, you are going to have a child. That child ought to be strong. I'm strongly saying this. I'm not saying you must. I'm just strongly suggesting breastfeeding is the way to go. It is the way to go, and it will prepare your baby better than any formula, any chemical substance they're calling a formula will ever prepare your baby. I'm not saying you can't do it, but I want to say that for all those mothers that's doing this formula thing, you know, coconut milk and coconut water is the closest thing to breast milk that they have. So you didn't never have to do those components that they call formula. I'm just saying.
Right. But try to get the coconut milk or the coconut water in a bottle. Don't get it in a can.
Or you can make it yourself.
Or make your own, absolutely. Or make it yourself. Yes, but don't get it in the can, because...
No.
Right,
and,
because...
Yeah, and see, there's only one company that I am aware of that does raw coconut. That means it's not pasteurized. Which means
right,
it's not cooked.
Right.
Right. The nutrients are gone, all right? So the only
right.
one that I know is actually called raw coconut, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of pricey. That's why I suggest you buy your own coconut and you make your own coconut milk and do not throw the coconut water away.
Away,
all
right? Right.
Do not throw that away, because that's the good stuff. You can strain out that coconut water and put it in the bottle and give it to the baby, and shortly, baby will be fantastic.
Yes, that's right. And you can make hemp milk also from the hemp seed.
That's right.
So we've tried all those things.
Also sesame seed, because if you were low in calcium, sesame seed milk will
mm-hmm.
restore your calcium level. So, of course, if you're breastfeeding and you're drinking sesame seed, natural sesame seed milk, then you're gonna have enough calcium in your body to make sure that baby has the necessary bone foundation. And even if you're pregnant, you ought to be drinking sesame seed milk too, because if you don't have enough calcium, this is why, and a lot of people probably don't know this. The reason that they have mothers going to the dentist these days when you're pregnant is because you're low in calcium.
Right.
Calcium, that once you get pregnant, the baby is going to pull whatever calcium you got. And so if you're deficient in calcium, you will find your teeth shift, they become loose, so to maintain or actually to build up before you get pregnant, drink sesame seed milk. While you're pregnant, drink sesame seed milk, because it will restore your calcium level. That's like the highest calcium. I don't even know why they promote milk, because milk, really, cow's milk, first of all, if you're not a cow, you shouldn't be drinking cow's milk.
That's right. Cow's milk is for the cow's children.
That's right. And if you're drinking cow's milk, you got a lot of medical problems, so that ain't nothing but a whole bunch of mucus and stuff that I won't go into right now.
Right.
You out.
Hey, can I give a shout out?
Go ahead.
I give a shout out. I'm not going to say the brother's name because I didn't speak to him yet, but me and another brother will get together and do a segment on health, on fasting, and on just your health, all right, and the parts of the body and things like that. So that's going to be coming soon. So I just wanted to give a shout-out to that. About detoxing the body, preparing the body to get rid of that old stuff. And this is good to the point of the mother preparing herself for a child. You know, you don't want to hear, oh, it was an accident or this or that, preparing the body. So if you weren't conscious and you're becoming conscious now, we're going to go into a detox process. I'm just coming off of it. Today, matter of fact, ended a 21-day fast, and part of the fast was just water.
That is amazing, because you know what I want to do? And I'm going to make this announcement on the Tuesday for our 10th as well. I want to do a 30-day fast. And anybody who is a 30-day water fast, all right, because let me just say that. I'm going to do a 30-day water fast. I want to know if anyone out there would like to join me in this 30-day fast. What I want everybody to do is to document every day, how you felt, even if you slip back, don't kill yourself. Just, the goal is to do a 30-day water fast. If we do a 30-day water fast, document it, and then we'll do a broadcast show where we have everybody who participated and did the 30-day fast comment, talk about what they felt, what they experienced, any kind of negative side effects they had, how they resolved it. I'm thinking that would be a wonderful experience, and everybody can feel like it. Sometimes when you do a fast, you feel like you're all alone. So this would be a way that you can do it. And we can all feel like we're doing it together, and, we can, what I can do? I can even, if you're comfortable, we can create a journal and we can publish it, and, not everything, but, just something, because this is our heritage, being able to fast. One of the things
that's
we did every spring is we fasted. Now, and they talk about it in the bibliophiliotech, and I know myself personally, I always wondered, why do we do a fast in the spring? Well, let me tell you, in the winter, what they did was more to gain more fat or heat. And in the spring,
you did a fast to get rid of it. You know, right. So it was that. And, of course, there were health reasons. But, you know, I'm going to mention it on Tuesday, and you know, but I want to mention it here. If anybody is agreeable, send an email to mhhs@gmail.com. Let me know what you think about that idea. So,
yeah. Great. And I think it's important that you prepare for the fast also. So set a date and time when you're going to begin that. But prior to that, we've been talking about preparation, that you prepare the body and the spirit for the fast. Because once you find that, one of the things you'll find out, let's say some people say, okay, I'm going to fast because I'm in bad health and I know my eating habits have been bad and this and that, and they totally leave out the spiritual thing. But once you get into the fast, then the spiritual thing comes into place. Because I'll say this, once you start a fast, especially a water fast, it's very important to understand the water fast, all right? After a number of days, and I'm going to talk spiritually here, but I'm going to talk about the flesh. After another number of days, what will happen is that the body wants to get rid of the flesh. Because remember, food is just for the body, all right? And so the body isn't receiving no food. No, none of those type of substances. So after a number of days, the body will turn on itself, preservation, and start eating. First, it'll start eating any external or foreign objects in the body, viruses and these things. And if you do it proper preparation, tapeworms and these things, the body will start someone getting those things out of his body, they'll start running because the body start turning on itself, and then the body will start getting rid of the flesh and start eating the flesh. Now what's happening is you're moving on a spiritual level, all right? You're becoming lighter because the body isn't receiving food because food is only for the body. So now what's happening is that the spirit gets stronger. You'll start experiencing that. So it's best to become aware of these things and talk and discuss these things when you talking about the fast, because there's several different types of fast, but the water fast is very, very significant and very, very important. But it has to be done properly, because what you're doing is you're changing your body's clock. And when you change your body's clock, when you start it up again, all right, it's a proper time to eat and it's a proper time to rest. But I'm not going to go into all that. I'm just making that enlightenment to make a point. You know, I hope it becomes intriguing what I'm saying to those who's listening, that they might want to call in and want to be join and become a part of that 30-day fast that you're putting out there. Because you're able to create your own reality and change your own clock, all right? The eating pattern, the way that your body, when your body will absorb the minerals and the vitamins or the food that you put in it and things like that, and you'll restart your body again. This time when you restart it, you're restarting it with a different consciousness and a different understanding, you know. And as they say, you know better, then you'll do better. And understand that when you hear the word diet, we talk about this all the time, that don't mean something that you go on to lose weight or something. When you hear diet, it's just simply the foods and things that you eat or consume. You know, so we get correct those consciousness, preparing the person for the fast, you know, and you'll have great results. You'll have great results, and you'll be healthier, and you'll be conscious, and you'll become conscious on so many other different levels. because it heightened your senses of smell. You'll get around meat and you won't like meat. You know, it'll stink instead of feel stink, or it'll smell unwanted instead of like something that you want. We'll be walking in, like when I was in the Philadelphia territory, and there's cheesesteak places, and you can smell it in the air, you know, and you want that taste for meat. Well, what happens is that when you prepare yourself and you go through those things and you smell that, it won't smell favorable to you anymore, you know, once you expel those things from your body and stuff. So I'll just leave it there and yield the floor with that.
All right. Well, that is mine, and thank you so much for that. Well, let's see. It is almost 3:30, and our broadcast goes down at, well, actually, we have until 4:30. But if anyone has a question, comment, or concern, press 1 on your telephone dial. We'll take a couple of callers, and we will end our broadcast.
We certainly shared enough information to take into the plenty of
it. Yeah, you're right. You're right. I want to say thank you to the sisters, Christina and what's the other sister's name?
Shantae.
They were on another broadcast last week.
I want to say thank you for, you know, going through this so that we can have this, you know, we can share any experience, we can talk about it. I want to say thank you to William and Cameo also for being the, oh, and it's them, for being the wonderful, wonderful, wonderful son that you all are, for sharing and for, you know, just having that positive energy. And thank you so much for standing by the mothers so that they can do what they got to do. And thank you all for being a wonderful example for all of us.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know what, we can't leave out Mother Teresa. I know she's around here somewhere.
Right. Yes, Mother Teresa,
she did.
Hey, listen, we got to say thank you to all the sisters for even allowing the sons to speak on these experiences as well. But Mother Teresa, she behind the scenes, but she's on it. She's listening. We give a salute to her.
Hey, yes, that's my mother, and she makes it known that this is a matriarch, not a patriarch, and we are to sit at her feet, Islam.
That's the key. Yep. Hey, listen, when they came into the hospital room to do a little christening, as they call it, or gracing or blessing on the child, they were coming from that patriarchal position, unfortunately, even if it was a female. That's the biggest thing we have to understand, is we are natural beings in tune with nature. Nature is a matriarch and not a patriarch, and that's all we're trying to say, because that's the only way you're going to get back. We, as a nation, are going to get back in order. That's it. We have to understand that. From that, everything else just unfolds, doesn't it, sons? Isn't that what you found out to be true, all of you sons on the line today sharing this experience?
Absolutely.
All right.
Absolutely.
All right.
Well, look, I got one caller, and we got probably enough time to take this call, and then we're going to close out the show. So, caller 619-303, you are live on the air. Please state your appellation at.
Hi, I am Felicia. Can you hear me all right?
Yeah,
smile,
I can hear you.
Absolutely.
All right, I liked both of your testimonies or your statements. It was very
appreciate
wonderful.
Appreciate it.
I have one. Well, actually, I have two questions, but let me ask the one big question first. In the Clock of Destiny, Volume 1, did the mothers participate in pages 27, 28 and 31 and 32? Do you know?
Say that again. Mention that question again? In the Clock of Destiny 1.
Clock of Destiny pages 21, 22, and 1.
Okay.
Page 27 and 28.
Uh-huh.
Also page 30.
Go ahead.
Also page 31 and 32. Do you know if they participated in?
You know what? If you just hold on 1 second, so I can look at that real quick. Let me
okay,
just
what is your question? What is your
all right? He's asking, do mothers participate in that? Is that what you asked?
Yeah. Did they were they aware of reading that information in Clock of Destiny, Volume 1?
Oh, I know what she's saying on page 27, which tells you the conception. Yes, 27 and 28, and it tells you about, right here it says, after they tell you that if you conceive at a certain time, the child will be born at a certain time, and then it says, and I think we've read this before on the show, this is the scientific universal fact, proving that every child is born while the sun is passing through one of the signs, and that the sign under which the children are born governs their lives from the cradle to the grave. That which cannot be proven by mathematics reasoning is definitely dangerous to human progress. And then it says this. I know what she's talking about, Annie. We brought this out before. This is a perfect time, Sister Felicia, to bring it up. The question is, do they know about this? Well, unless they've read that book as you have, they would not know the following. Let me just say it briefly. During 9 months from conception to birth, the child in its creator's womb, namely the mother, has passed through the 9 cosmic regions or signs of the earth in harmony with the sun, from which it molds its physical form, mind, memory, and characteristics, qualified for cultivation as it slowly grows up during life. Here it is. This is the thing. This is the point right here. Next line. If women on national scales possess the applied knowledge of the secret of the number 9 or of the womb, they would be supremely qualified to educate their children to the practical side of life during its 9 months maturity from conception to birth. Then there would be no need for the institutions of religious mystery worship, idol or image gods, jail houses, prisons, and insane institutions would not be needed, for there would be no racial hatred or crime. Islam, that starts on page 27. Thank you for that.
So sisters do participate in it. Is that was her question? Do sisters participate in it?
Well,
what do you mean? Of course, they're supposed to.
So I'm asking the sister, was that her question?
No, her question was, did Christina and Shante, were they aware of that conception?
Put Christina on the phone and things.
Well, Christina is actually
she's not
laboring.
There.
She's hearing it, but she's laboring it as well now.
Okay.
But definitely, yes.
For all sisters is that that's one of the things that we were talking about earlier in preparation, that we talked about the things that we had to deal with in the flesh, you know, like being at the physical hospital, what the things to eat, but also we talked on the spiritual level, because we did understand that the mother, every thought, every feeling, every thing that she says, the baby hears and also feels those things. So we talked about that on that level. You know, with the mother, you know, to be conscious. You know, my wife sat down, and then to that point, we were having discussions about, you know, one of the things that's
mothers can do around the nation is start up a website or start up a conference call where mothers who are impregnated or if they in the same community meet up as the four mothers did when they heard that a woman was with child. The mothers used to come around the mother and that was with child, and the elder mothers used to talk to them and did things to comfort her and stuff, and talked about things, knowing that the baby would hear and feel these things, you know. So this take it further from just the book, because you know the CNA and these book CNBay and these books we read them on the cardinal level, but they are code of things on a spiritual level and things that you should be doing also. So Islam to that. I hope that covers the sister question. Yes, that's one of the things that we talked about as a family.
It's kind of like mandatory to get that that's important, because also I just want to interject here, and well, I don't need to interject this, but people should just read that page 27, Clock of Destiny 1 and 28. And sister, what was the other page you mentioned? 27, 28, and
28 and 29.
31 and 32.
Well, all the way through from 27 to 32, then.
Yeah, that would be very adequate.
Oh, yes, the intelligent zodiac,
yeah.
Yes, absolutely. And also to add on top of that, Christina actually did study one other thing, that it's 12 zodiac signs, and she carries the baby for 9 of them. And for the other three, the baby actually, or the child actually yawns for those other three zodiac signs. But first we started in learning the zodiac signs. And you are you have a part of each zodiac inside of you throughout each time while the baby is inside of the womb. And when the baby comes out the womb, the three zodiacs that the baby did not go through, those are the three that the baby are attracted to.
Now,
right.
Now I tell you something. That's an astrology lesson, and what you just said is really family planning, because if you have other children, as we used to always have fairly large families, if you have other children, the true family planning thing that includes your other siblings who may have those qualities that child needs. And that's really all about the family, too, you know. So this is, this is interesting.
And when we understand the zodiacs and we understand those signs and we put the math to this, to these things, because remember, we Moors, we're scientists. We always have to put the math to these things because the math come out exact and correct. And so those three signs that he's talking about, when you study those and put them in your cipher, then you understand the salt. You understand what's the makeup of those signs, all right? You know, what parts of the body that those signs equate to. And so you understand those things, and so you're able to feed that to the child also on the physical level, the salts and the things that the child is missing and stuff like that. So just don't think just those signs. Understand those signs and break them down and then add it up, and then you come to the total of that, you know. So, you know, Islam. So those are things we talk about and we've been talking about, you know, just understanding that whole thing. And we know that's Ra's thing. I learned a lot of this from Ra's and Annie E. You know, I mean, I sat in her living room with both of y'all, and I mean, I have to tell y'all this here. I mean, I hear a lot of times when I call in and y'all are you guys are thanking me and giving me honor and thanks all the time. And I accept that and embrace that. But I also want you mothers to know, as far as I'm concerned, and my wife, you know, because I share these experiences with her, is that what you guys have done for me, it's been unmeasurable. I just want y'all to know that it's been unmeasurable, because some of these things, you know, 3-4 years ago, and I done been with you guys for a while now, a number of years, that I want to say this. Ignorance is a terrible thing, and you know how I know? I was once ignorant. I tell people right. this all the time, and it's a terrible thing. And sitting with you and things, I was able to understand my mother, my father, that whole situation, you know, to be able to understand myself as an initial thing, to be able to understand myself, you know. And I just want to thank you, thank you, thank you publicly and on the record that the work that you guys do is unmeasurable for building this nation, for help building this nation and rebuilding this nation, I want to say. The work, you, I always conceive it like this here, as bricks. We all are bricks, you know, building a strong wall. But the straw that you put in your bricks, you know, that brick, if you drop it, won't crack and won't break, you know. So
that reminds me of what the prophet said. He said what? He said, I bought you something that you can't tear down. That's what you're reiterating.
So that's what y'all done for me, and consequently y'all have done for my family, you know, or our family. And I just want, I just can't thank you guys enough. I just want y'all to know that from the top of my heart to the bottom.
Listen, I got to say this. Thank you for that. However, this, I want to be sure we're just reiterating that which is, you know, it's nothing new under the sun. It is, as you stated, when we're in that state of ignorance and still asleep, cannot receive these gifts of understanding, let's put it that way. And so we're passing on how I understand it. And believe me, it takes a long time, doesn't it? Understand, you know, this is why the prophet said, and we say, study, study, study. Because there's a whole lot of things that have been said to myself and to all of us listening, and at the time it was said, it didn't become a revelation to us on a personal level until it became a revelation to us on a personal level. Then you understand what really has already been done and said, you know. So
that's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
And I just want to say one more thing before you close the show too.
Always the sister did have one more question too.
Dushi, go ahead.
Yes, he's right. Did you all do a chart for your babies? And one baby was a son. was the other baby a son or a daughter? I didn't get that information.
Justice was a son as well. Yes.
Oh, two sons. All right. And did they have charts? Did you have their charts?
Yes.
Did you do their charts?
Yes, we did the charts off of their exact timing of birth, their exact month, their location on this grid, and, you know, you put those all together. And we did have a help from a mother who really doesn't do too much of that anymore, but she did help us out with that, Islam.
Yeah,
yes,
it's really beautiful to know. Yeah, it's beautiful to know about your children, the charts, and yourself. As my studies have brought me to, I'm still studying. I mean, it's just great.
Yeah.
I mean, how could we not have this information?
Right.
Well,
I know.
I actually had my chart done, and I did learn that during the full moon, I am actually overly sensitive. So now I have to take in consideration at least once a month for about 3 or 4 days, I cannot do contracts. I cannot, you know, get into any personal conversations because I would take it too personal. And, you know, I would get – so I had to learn that stuff about me, and I didn't know until I actually did my chart.
Oh, there you go. Man, know thyself. That's right. And then by knowing – see, all astrology is just – we're all energy. It's just it just explains those energies and how they interact. And so once we – understand that we not only know ourselves, we will be better understanding other people, you know, because remember it's been said, the Prophet Noble Joy Lee said it best as far as I know. He says others see you more plainly when you do not see yourself. So this is why he said, all right, you think you studied and studied well, well, I tell you, the next thing for you to study is yourself.
And self, that's right.
That's right. And then you can, now you can go forth with, look for the best in others and give the best in of yourself. You see, so, and now the zodiac wheel with the little depictions on it are, is left for us to teach our children and to understand and have them understand these energies also. Those are the elementaries. They really are the elements. So, you know, so you're just expressing that. Now, you're saying that you're oversensitive. You might have a lot of water or the moon guide or whatever like that. And by you understanding that, don't you feel better about yourself now?
Yes, I do, if you're asking me, yes.
Well, yeah, I was saying that's fine with you, but it's same with the, I think that was William. Yes. He feels better about himself because he understands himself, and he can navigate better and know what he can and cannot do and what he does best, et cetera, like that, you know. So,
right. Go ahead, Sean.
No, go ahead.
Oh, we understand that. Go ahead, Camille.
No, go ahead. I was just on mute, but go ahead.
That's one of our protections also.
Yes.
That's one of our protections once we understand it. So, you know, divinely, by default, knowing these things and as we continue to learn, we find these things to be also our protection and help, you know, because when we know when to do things, when to deal with other people versus dealing with other people when we shouldn't be dealing with them, you know, once we know these things, this is another form of protection also.
Mm-hmm.
So understand that too, family, how powerful this thing is, that these things, once you know these things and not ignorant to them no more, how they work in your favor and on your behalf in just every phase of your life, you know. So with that, did the sister have any more questions?
No, just a comment. I just love this subject. This motherhood subject, it is one of the best subjects.
Well, I just want to let you know this. I don't know if you listened to us last month. Last month,
I remember
we had the mother.
Yeah.
Oh, all
he
right. For anyone listening, this is a two-part series. And you know what? I think what we might do is, you know, make it a set. We might, you know, make it available to people. What do you think, Brian? Because this is very important, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Bringing
yeah.
of the energy. So what we're probably going to do is we're going to, you know, make these two CDs a set and make it available. And you know what? I think the title of tonight's broadcast is so appropriate, Mother and Son, a United Family. Hey,
yeah.
How about that?
Well, it's love, you.
That's all there is mother and son, man. I'm telling you, you know, I think you mentioned, yes, we mentioned it before. You're born a mother's son, and you will pass form as a mother's son, and you know what? It's like you may gain a title of husband, and you may, which means housebinder, you may gain the title of father, you may gain the title of whatever, a husband five times, who knows, I don't know, but you are still a mother's son, and so shall you pass form as a mother's son,
a mother's
born
son.
In
it. That's right.
That's
absolutely.
All there is.
Mom.
And if
absolutely.
We could get that, we'd be good.
And I just wanted to say this, too. After giving honor and thanks to the mothers, I always be mindful of our prophet and have to give honor, thanks, and praise to the prophet for taking a stand at the time that he did accept his calling and bring us our nationality and our divine creed to make us conscious over 100 years ago that we've been able to sit on this call and have this call today.
Yes.
To help the uplift and the fallen humanity.
Absolutely. Sister, thank you so much for your call.
And you're just welcome. To add on top of that, Christina is right now currently in school to be a doula, and she's going to work her way to be a midwife. So we will give you guys that information. So if anybody is needing of any assistance, we are definitely more than willing. Well, she told me I had her permission. She's more than willing to help out in any way. And if she can help bring the life into this world, she will. Islam.
Thank you. Wonderful, wonderful. And the sister Felicia that's on the line, I do recall her on, I believe, our first part of this series. And she was really appreciated what was being discussed. And she kind of is in that field in some way, if I recall correctly. So I know Sister Felicia is resonating with, as she just said, with the information. So thank you for your call again.
Okay, we have one more caller.
And after that caller, I just want to close out with something from about children. So, you know.
All right. Go ahead. Mm-hmm. Call 510-334. You are live on the air. Please state your appellation and what's the maximum.
Peace and love. I am Anthony Shanko Bay, Northwest Master.
Good evening.
I just wanted to share that, wonderful, wonderful broadcast. Perfect timing. I actually have a niece that is, she's pregnant. And I was in the room when she was being born, and so she could not wait to tell me the news. We grew up as Christians, and her mom is a – thank you, thank you. And her mom is a physician assistant. So – and I also work in the hospital. I'm excited because she – seems to be open to the Moorish paradigm, and her mate seems to be open to it as well. My plan is to have her listen to this broadcast and take it one step at a time. But I did just want to share that I want to be there for her. And just make myself available. This is my niece. I feel like she's my daughter because we're that close. Let me just say this. They're together, but that's another issue. But the main thing is there's a baby coming that we can not have part of their municipal corporation, as you've demonstrated.
All righty.
Absolutely. Can I ask you a question? You're working inside of the hospital. How do you feel about the vaccinations of it? Because I did talk to my son isn't vaccinated, nor is my nephew, and we don't believe in the vaccinations. However, I do know some people that work inside of the hospital, and they are still, you know, with the vaccinations because of what they, you know, quotation fingers right now, are taught in medical school or they're taught in their certificate school.
I'm totally against it. When I came into this information, they came around with their blitzes to get your flu shot and all this kind of nonsense. I just say no. And sometimes I even wrote all rights reserve on the paper that they issued, and then they say, oh, this form is got lost. That's just demonstrating the power of writing that on there. But still, to answer your question, I'm not for it at all. And I work in the engineering department, so whenever something breaks in the room or in the hospital, if power goes off, that's when I am activated. So the medical side of things, I can go in and see some things, but that's my ask. That's my relation there with what's there. I go there, I'm able to provide for my family. And I need to have a conversation with her along those lines and even introduce more information along the Moorish paradigm. And I don't, and I want to see if I can even encourage her not to. I did give her the Lotus Blossom YouTube video. She did watch it. And
nice.
We'll take it from there.
All right. All right, well, congratulations, and thank you for your call.
You're welcome.
All righty,
peace and love.
All righty, so that concludes this broadcast. Roz is going to read something.
I just wanted to say, and I know that many have already read Chapter 23 of the Circle 7 Holy Quran, divinely prepared by Prophet Nubuju Ali, and Chapter 23 is in regards to the holy instructions for thy children. And I would be a dishonor if I just said, look, just go to 8, and you'll see he's talking about a short brief on each astrology sign. So I'm just going to read it. It's not that long, and that it's not long at all.
Before you read that, what I would like to do is I want you to read that, and then I'm just going to play the music, and we're going to end the broadcast. So before you start reading, I want to let everyone know that I'm very thankful. I'm very thankful for the son's participation, for the mother's participation, for our listeners' participation. Thank you so much for joining us today, and make sure and join us back here on Tuesday for Principles of Nationality in Action, and that broadcast begins at 9:30. So with that, over to you, Ron.
All right. Well, actually, I'm going to read two things. I have to. One is Khalil Gibran. So I'm going to do his first because the highest honor goes to a Prophet Nubuju Ali. So I'm going to read his last. But first, understand what Khalil Gibran is saying about children. Then you go to chapter 23 and see what, not only what the Prophet says, but he gives you instructions on how to deal or how to, deal with the raising of your children. So Khalil Gibran says here on children, and it says as follows, and the woman who was holding a babe against her bosom said, please speak to us of children. And he said, your children are not your children. They are the sons and daughters of life's longing for itself. They come through you, but not from you. And though they are with you, yet they belong not to you. You may give them your love, but not your thoughts, for they have their own thoughts. You may house their bodies, but not their souls, for their souls dwell in the house of tomorrow, which you cannot visit, not even in your dream. You may strive to be like them, but seek not to make them like you. For life goes not backwards, nor tarries with yesterday. You are the bows from which your children, as living arrows, are set forth. The archer sees the mark upon the path of the infinite, and he bends you with his might that his arrows may go swift and far. Let your bending in the archer's hand be for gladness, for even as he loves the arrow that flies, so he loves also the bow that is stable. And I want to say, all children, our ancestors return as you are. So along this path as we go and we learn our lessons and to go towards perfection, just remember that, as you said, these are your children, but they're really the children of the universe. So now, in getting a little bit more involved, I would say, and instructions on your children, you go to Chapter 23, Holy Instructions for Thy Children, out of the Circle 7 Holy Quran, divinely prepared by Prophet Nubuju Ali. It says, consider thou art a parent, the importance of thy trust, the being thou hast produced, it is thy duty to support. Upon thee also it dependeth whether the child of the bosom be a blessing or a curse to thyself, or a useful or a worthless member to the community. Prepare him early with instructions, and season his mind with the maxims of truth. Watch the bent of his inclinations set him right in his youth, and let no evil habit gain strength with his years. So shall he rise like a cedar on the mountain. His head shall be seen above the trees of the forest. A wicked son is a reproach to his father, but he that doth right is an honor to his gray hair. The soil is thine own. Let it not want cultivation. The seed which thou hast sown, that also shall thou reap. Teach him. Now, right here, this is where the prophet is giving you. This is the sign and the symbols and the what you would say. It's not quote. It's right there if you know astrology. Number 8 is where he starts talking about each sign and the basic short of it. Starting with Aries, teach him obedience, and he shall bless the. And he shall bless thee. Teach him modesty, Taurus, and he shall not be ashamed. Teach him gratitude, Gemini, and he shall receive benefit. Teach him charity, Cancer, and he shall gain love. Teach him temperance, and he shall have health, Virgo. Teach him prudence, and fortune shall attend him, Leo. Teach him justice, Libra, and he shall be honored by the world. Teach him sincerity, Scorpio, and his own heart shall not reproach him. Teach him benevolence, Sagittarius, and his mind shall be exalted. Teach him diligence, Capricorn, and his wealth shall increase. Teach him science, Aquarius, and his life shall be useful. Teach him religion, Pisces, and his death shall be happy. Islam, peace and love.